Are we live now? Hi. Okay, perfect. So, good morning, everyone. Welcome to Charcha 2021. My name is Rahul. I'm one of the co-founders of Arthan. This is a collaboration between us at Arthan and Nudge Foundation on this excellent event called Charcha 2021, which is on based on Career Connect. The idea of this whole day's event would be to give all our participants access to opportunities to understand the social impact sector better. Also, it gives you a chance to interact with different people, different personalities who have made it in the social impact sector. At the same time, later in the day, we will have close to 9 organizations who are coming today and are literally sharing all the open opportunities in their respective organizations, which you can gain access to. Just to give you a very quick introduction of my esteemed panel today. So first speaker that we have today is Vasudha Chakravarti. She's the co-founding partner at Development Solutions. Vasudha has over 11 years of experience working on issues of public health, sexual and reproductive health, education and gender. She has led and managed evaluations, research studies and strategy development. She was one of the 10 fellows globally selected by the Maternal Health Task Force, Harvard School of Public Health, to undertake research on maternal health. At present, she is leading the evaluation of online interventions to understand their impact on young people, SRHR knowledge and practices. Vasudha has a master's degree in public health from SRM University, Tamil Nadu. Welcome, Vasudha, today.
Thanks so much, Rahul.
Yeah. Our second speaker today is Kruti Barucha, founder and CEO of People. Kruti Barucha, prior to People, she was the country head for ARC India and led ARC India's work to pioneer public-private partnership schools in Delhi. Her previous roles include senior director and leader of the finance practice for CEB, advising CXOs in the areas of corporate finance, internal controls, talent management, finance function, productivity, and information risk management and mitigation. Her previous work experience includes McKinsey and Company, where her expertise was in the field of consumer goods, retail, and agribusiness. She has also worked at the World Bank and the IMF, where she specialized in fiscal policy and financial sector reform. She has an MSc in Development Studies with distinction from the London School of Economics and Political Science, an MA in Economics from the University of Maryland, and a BA with honors from LSR, University of Delhi. Welcome, Kruti, to the discussion. Then our last speaker today is Akanksha Gulati. She's the Chief Program Officer at Teach for India. She leads the strategy and program design at Teach for India, which includes supporting fellowship recruitment and alumni impact. Prior to her transition into the education sector, Akanksha worked at the BCG on projects spanning credit strategy, organizational transformation, pre-merger planning, and strategic planning for various banking sector clients. Prior to BCG, she worked in New York with Keefe, Bruyette, and Woods as an assistant vice president with Lehman Brothers, later Barclays Capital, as an analyst on securitization and mortgage trading desk. Akanksha was an FC Austin scholar at the Kellogg School of Management, where she completed her MBA and graduated magna cum laude with a double bachelor's degree in mathematics and economics from the Duke University. She believes that anyone who is interested in cross-disciplinary and innovative approaches to problem solving ought to consider working in the education sector. Welcome, Akanksha, to the discussion today. So I think it was a very long introduction. So I think I will step straight into the discussion today. Would love to understand from each one of you, how has it been transitioning into the sector? What is your story to transition into the social impact sector? Maybe we can start with Kruti, then Akanksha, then Vasudha. Yeah.
Super. Thanks, Rahul. Very glad to be here. I'll keep it short. I think when somebody gets me started on this question, I go on for like 10, 15 minutes. So I'll keep it short. What a lot of people don't know is that I've always been very passionate and, you know, interested in education specifically. It started actually, so I did my master's in development studies from LSE, and then it was fantastic. It was just a mix of folks across sectors. And I was very keen to come back to India to start my professional journey. I think I didn't want to stay on in the UK. And got an offer from McKinsey & Company to join. And so all of my peers and friends at LSE thought I was, you know, such a traitor for leaving the development sector and going into the corporate world. I think I felt that I really wanted to see the way that business works, get a sense of, you know, the micro before thinking about development and policy issues. At McKinsey is when my spark and interest in education actually started. This is the year 2000, long time ago. And McKinsey was working on a pro bono study with Pratham. Pratham was in Mumbai at the time, and they were looking at expansion. They were looking at setting up their board. And so I started, you know, latching on to that engagement, trying to volunteer, help out where I could. And that's where the inspiration happened, you know, and I just felt that some of the work that was happening when I went to the communities, met Bal Sakhi, saw the Balwadis in action. It was just extremely inspiring to see, you know, young women kind of pick up and make that change happen. Went to the World Bank while I was working on the finance practice, found my way into education. And so that interest was there, has been there for a couple of decades. But, you know, found myself moving then to the corporate and advisory space. And when I made, you know, when I hit a professional milestone in my career at Corporate Executive Board, I had been put up for managing director, which was relatively hard to come by in terms of promotions. For me, I had hit a certain professional milestone for myself, right? And when I asked myself, what do I want to do for the rest of my career? I really found myself gravitating back to development. I felt that was my purpose, and specifically in education. I think the other thing that I haven't actually talked to a lot of people about is my son was born in 2009. I made the shift in 2013-14. But you know, when he was born, he had several health issues for the first couple of years of his life, and he overcame those issues. But I had the resources and the support system at that point to actually help him overcome a lot of the health issues that he had, and for him to actually, you know, hit his, you know, development milestones. But I also found that there were so many children who were just falling through the cracks, right? They did not have, their parents did not have the resources, did not know where to look for in terms of getting support. And teachers as well were also, you know, sometimes divided within government school systems and other school systems in terms of how to actually ensure that every child lives up to their potential. So a combination of these things, both my personal experience with my own son, as well as, you know, achieving that professional milestone, is what caused me to then shift to education. I think the question at that point was, and I promise I'll stop after a minute. The question for me at that point was, what's the right role and the right organization, right? Because I had not played a full-time role in the space. And, you know, had known about PFI, knew about Pratham, but really didn't know about any other organizations in the space. So I was fairly ignorant. And then it was a question of, you know, spending 4 or 5 months actually understanding what opportunities would look like. And that's what I would love, you know, for us to also do today, which is just help folks understand who are looking to make this shift. You know, what exists, you know, there are high-paced, dynamic organizations that exist in the space and are looking for great talent. So would love to share this in the context of helping more people make this shift.
Perfect. Thanks a lot, Kruti. I think saw a very strong blend of how professionally you had to think beyond what you were doing, but at the same time, you also had a personal story to share about what pushed you to think about equity, being resourceful for your own child, but what about so many children outside of your life, right? And you have, you kind of merged both of those things together. But what about you, Akanksha? Was it a combination of both personal and professional? What happened to you in United States, which brought you to India and now doing what you do at Teach for India?
Yeah. So first of all, lots of similarities between Kruti and my story, some differences. So maybe I'll highlight those a little bit more. At the risk of sounding dramatic, I will say, like, I feel like I always knew that ultimately this is the sector that I wanted to work in, right? And I mean, if you talk to my mother, she'll like even tell you, I think as early as I was 6, 7, 8 years old, I would come back from school and I would literally be sitting in front of a mirror or just teaching an imaginary audience, right? So even at that age, I just felt there are better ways to teach and learn, and I'd constantly be tinkering to figure out how is it that people really learn, what makes individuals realize their full potential, so on and so forth. So it was just something I was always kind of obsessed with, to the point that that's really what I was drawn to, right? Like, I was drawn to people who were, you know, kind of making a larger impact throughout, I guess, high school, college. I was always volunteering. And so it kind of became like, it became like two journeys, I felt. Like, you know, on top, the more visible part of my journey was I was a very achievement-oriented individual, you know, who was very analytical and loved problem solving. So, you know, was studying all the things you mentioned in my introduction, right? I was, and then came out as a strategy consultant. But underneath the surface, like in each of those parts of my journey, you know, I was getting my math and economics degree, but I was also getting my teaching licensure while I was at Duke University, right? So I had found that there was a way to finish my majors early in 3 years. And in those 3 years, I took curriculum design, ed psychology, child behavior, like all the, and then I spent my final year in college teaching full time because I just wanted to get like licensed as a teacher, trader by day, you know, running my own NGO out of New York by night, getting my MBA, but I was part of every single like incubator related to education and social impact. Had joined BCG New York because they had this huge social impact practice. So thought, you know, I'll start out in the financial services practice and then I'll find my way to the social impact practice. So it was just a theme that was constantly, you know, a parallel running theme. Few inflection points in my life, Rahul, which is where the one is, like, I think I was just kind of born with some weird gene that was always there. But I think in terms of events, few that I, you know, that I think played a big role. One was when I was, you know, in 6th, 7th, 8th, 9th grade, we had moved to the US. And there I was enrolled in a public school, so free education. And it really just pushed me on what a good education even is, right? So I always thought it's math and science. Mm-hmm. And all of a sudden I realized like literature could be really analytical, you know, that there's more to a good education than just, you know, content. It's values. Yeah. It's lots of other things that make a big part of how you develop and what you learn and what you do in the world. The other thing was, you know, technology was fairly absent, I think, in classrooms in India. And there, you know, you were starting to see some of that. So I started thinking a lot about what is the best way to deliver an education and how is it not just teacher, but what's the role that parents play, communities play, environment plays, technology, so on and so forth. And then the third big question in my mind was, how do you really get it to everyone? You know, like, how can it not be reserved for a few? Which I felt in India it was, you know, like the state of public education and what every single child was getting was a big question. So that was one big inflection point where some of these early questions got formed. I think the other big inflection point in my life was the fact that my first job was as a which basically then, you know, led to the global financial crisis. And I think planted some big questions in my mind, like what's the value that I wanted to create in the world? And the truth is I had destroyed value for the world in that first job. So now I say I commit, good thing is that I committed lots of sins early in my career. So now I can undo those sins. But these were a few inflection points. I think the third big one for me was I was lucky. I think as a 25, 26 year old, I was making $250,000. And so very early in my journey, I had realized that money was actually not motivating me, you know. And I think often people like go through that route of saying, I want to make more money, and then realize that's not, you know, giving them that ultimate happiness. So those were some of the early lessons. But unlike Kruti, I think the big difference in my journey was that I got to a point where I realized that I wasn't working in the social sector because of the peer pressure. Like everyone kind of had started telling me, but you're achievement oriented, why would you work in the social sector? You're at BCG, why would you want to work in education? And I think it kind of took a toll on me, where I was like, I just can't live these parallel lives. It's becoming very difficult to have a day job and try to do something else by night. I need them to converge. And so actually my journey was very abrupt. I said, look, actually a perfect time and place will never come. I turned 30. I said, let me just try it out. You know, like I have enough of a skill set where if I totally fumble and fail, you know, I can always come back. So it was very abrupt. I turned 30. I said, I'm going to take the leap. I didn't, similar to Kruti, had no idea where to start. Someone took a chance on me at an edtech startup. But so that was really the start of my journey. I'll end there now.
But thanks a lot for sharing your story, Akanksha. I have heard this before, so but I am glad that you shared it, and it's so fascinating to hear that both of you have so many similarities, but there's so many different routes that you both took. And I'm even more fascinated now to hear what Vasudha is going to share, because Vasudha figured out very early in her career that this is the sector that she'll stay. This is the sector she studied in. So Vasudha, over to you. What made you think of this sector so early in your life?
Yeah,
unlike the other two speakers.
Correct. Yeah. Unlike Akanksha and Kruti, I've spent like most of all of my years actually just working in development. So for me, I think it was a big part of my teenage. I came from a family where I lived with grandparents, and so I heard a lot of stories about distant cousins just finishing school and immediately getting married. Stories about how boys came to look at them, and then if they were too fat or too thin, that wasn't good enough. They got married very early, had children very early. And for me, it was just the phenomenal contrast to the life that I was leading. Like at 15, I was a rebellious teen. I don't think I listened to most of what people told me. And the fact was that I had a choice. And that sort of really stood out for me, that there are so many people who don't have a choice and who don't even know what that choice means. And that sort of thought, I think, just stayed with me. And I saw that through multiple things. Again, small incident, there was a very bright young woman who, during my grandmother's later stages, was helping us out at home. She must have been 19 or 20, and I must have still been finishing my school then. But it was phenomenal how bright she was, and that she was doing that job, because obviously she didn't have opportunities. And you know, she would sit along with me with a Tamil to English translation book and try to see if I can help her out in any small way, in terms of she had dropped out after class 8. And later on, you know, she had to go back, and eventually she was married. So these sort of things actually just stayed with me. And it was my motivation then, and it continues to be my motivation now. And which is why I love working. I mean, to me, the whole idea should be to work with young people, because that's where you actually get to know that you have choice. And in our country, there are so many things that actually shape who you become. There's a lot of social, cultural context. Like Kriti said, there aren't enough systems, and even Akanksha said, to ensure equal opportunities. And to me, it was always that, and it continues. It continues to remain that you know, at some point, some of us need to start working towards seeing how we can ensure that equity, how we can ensure that everybody has the same opportunities that we are sort of lucky to have.
Perfect. Thanks a lot, Vasudha. This is great. And I believe that so many people right now listening to us live would learn so much through each of your journeys, because there's so much that has triggered for each one of you, professionally, personally, and even deep stories, right, about your own loved ones or people around you. I am clearly seeing a trend of lack of equitable opportunities for the world around us, which has pushed us to do what we are doing right now. And like I said, please keep the questions coming. If there's anything that you feel that you need to get yourself out there with a question to any of us here, please feel free to do that. I think moving forward, I happen to also see a description of a lot of hard skills and soft skills throughout, even when I introduced you and even while you were sharing your personal journeys. So Akanksha, you mentioned that as a consultant, you built so many analytical skills, business-oriented skills, and now you are working at Teach for India. I'm sure that those skills still come in handy. But what are some of the things that you definitely think are important to be successful in the sector that you are right now in, which is the social impact sector? I believe Akanksha has lost connection. So Kruti, do you want to take that? You worked at World Bank and IMF. You were a part of strategy consulting firms as well. How do you think all of those experiences were helpful for you to be at your absolute best now?
A couple of things. I mean, I think coming into the role, what excited me, I had actually not heard of ARC at all. I'd heard of Teach for India and I'd heard of Pratham. But I looked at the job description and that really excited me, right? Mm-hmm. I think I saw the potential, because I didn't want to get into a siloed role. I felt that that was not my strength. There were other practitioners that were already in the sector that had those as their strengths and they would be able to apply those to good use in roles. I think what I felt was the job description showed me that there was a little bit of everything that I could do in the role of country director, right? And that is what really excited me. I think also in the space coming in, I would advise that folks kind of do something similar, right? Which is actually look carefully at the role itself and whether that's something that excites you. I also looked at the people that I would work with and whether those individuals inspired me. I may not have had the, again, practical practitioner experience, but I felt that the team and talent within the organization would help me achieve more or actually get to excellence and having impact. So I think, you know, the job description, the kind of talent and team, both of those were important to me as I was looking at making the shift. I think what I look for when we hire, I think talent is very critical to me. As we build the organization, I mean, we've gone from about a team of 40 folks about a year and a half ago, nearing 90 individuals now. So we've grown rapidly over the last year and a half through our programs and our team. I think talent at the end of the day is really critical. If we get the right talent, we're able to really make our programs transformative. So I look for diversity of experiences. I don't want to hire the same people. I don't want to hire folks who are mini-me's. I think it's important to find that diversity. The other thing I really look for is that fire in the belly, right? And this is not necessarily empathy or, mission alignment for the cause. Of course, that's important. But I look for the ability of that individual to make things happen. Right, to look at that opportunity, to grab it, and to make something special out of it. So I think that's very important to me, as well as a fit with our culture. I think we've been very careful to actually maintain a lot of the values of the organization as we've hired more and more folks on. And culture is very difficult to scale. So as we actually look at folks, we look at, you know, fire in the belly, the ability to be self-started and motivated, execution focused, and to be able to kind of take charge and make things happen and develop themselves. So that's what I look for. I think the final thing I would say is many nonprofits require individuals to wear many hats.
Yeah.
Many organizations require a certain agility. And I think you have to be open to that. It's extremely exciting to have that agility, right? It means that you don't have to be siloed into a particular role, but it also requires a particular mindset to be comfortable with ambiguity and to make the most of the various roles that you're playing.
Perfect. Thanks. Thanks a lot. You literally gave it away with so many literally bullet points about what you would look for in people if they are looking to transition. And honestly, most of these points have nothing to do with what the background of the person is. It's all about the softer side of what you would want to achieve through the role. And I'm glad that you touched upon that. Vasudha, you come from a very, very technical background, right? And even your organization works on research methodologies, impact evaluation. And I would love to hear about what is the kind of blend of hard skills and soft skills you look for in people that you hire? And what is the larger tip that you have for people who are looking to transition into the ecosystem of social impact?
Sure. I don't know if I have a specific tip, but I think Kruti has done brilliantly on sort of outlining some of those. But in terms of what we look at, so like you said, we work in the research and the impact space. So for us, there are certain roles that are very skill specific, and those are roles where we can't compromise on the skill set at all. So for me, somebody to have analytic skills or somebody to have writing skills, those are very critical. So when I'm looking for those very specific roles, the first point that we look at is the skill set. So we test for the skills, and that's the base that we look at. But like Kruti also said, there are a lot of generic roles. So the specific roles tend to be few, but managing projects is more of a slightly generalist sort of role. And for those roles, some of the key things that we look at, like also quickly mentioned, there needs to be a drive or a passion. So for anybody that we hire, why do you want to work in this space? And there is no right answer to it, but what we're looking for is to see that if there's something that really motivates them and something that will push the people to remain in that space. So for me, that drive, passion is absolutely important. Secondly, because a lot of our work is primary research driven and a lot of community interface, empathy is something that I definitely look for, because a lot of us who come from urban contexts to actually go to the kind of places that we go to gather data, it can really be it can be a transition. And you know, the idea of going there to gather information is to see how well you connect with the communities, how well you're able to get the kind of information that you need that's ultimately useful for program or policy. So for me, that to be able to see if they're able to understand the issues, make that sort of connect is the second thing that I think we sort of look for. Flexibility and adaptability is again critical. We're a small organization and we work across sectors. So, you know, it's possible that someday you're overseeing a health research, but, you know, maybe 2 months down the line, you may be working on an issue of education. So how adaptable are you, and how well can you make the connections between those spaces? Because there are a lot of, you know, aspects that interconnect when it finally comes to impact for communities. And finally, for me, it's a sort of appetite to learn, because there are newer methods, newer issues, the space itself is transitioning. You know, issues of livelihood 10 years ago to even now post-COVID is very different. So how much do you keep pushing yourself to learn about issues and to learn about and further your skill sets? So I think broadly, you know, these are the kinds of things, these are the kinds of things that we look for. Yeah.
Perfect. So from having the fire in your belly and being very focused on being agile, being adaptable, and also being very focused on hard skills, social sector is not about doing a favor. I constantly hear a lot of people saying that I have the heart and the drive to do it, but organizations don't want to hire me. But it's like, how you, I don't want anyone to treat an operation on my body if they are not a medical practitioner, right? And I think there are some specific technical skills that you need to be very strong at to do the work that we do. And if the problems that we are trying to solve for are there for centuries, you need the brightest minds to do it, right? And I think this is a big learning exercise for everyone here. You need to build your hard skills. Drive, passion, fire in the belly is not the only thing that will help you get there. So Akanksha, what about you? There are a couple of questions that I'm seeing in Q&A, people talking about, I'm a generalist, but are organizations open to generalists? I believe, Akanksha, knowing I have worked with you, I know you are a very strong generalist. What tips do you have? If you can answer this question along with, what are you looking for when you hire for people within Teach for India?
I'm just seeing some of the questions, and I think high level, I would say, look, the sector actually needs all the skills, right? So we need strong generalists who think more strategically, problem solving at a high level. We need more technical skills, like Vasudha mentioned, right? We need people who can do research, data, M&E. We need people who can be on ground, right? Execution for programs is really important. We need people at policy level. So long story short, I think whatever are the technical skills, generalist or specialist, that you, you know, lean towards, chances are that the sector will require those. But that's where the tough part comes in, right? I usually now pretty confidently tell people that you need more skills if you want to work in this sector, right? You need all of that. Plus, you need all the softer things that Kruti and Vasudha mentioned. And there, Rahul, if it's okay, I do want to add one, right? Like, I think the humility, the ability to learn, unlearn, you know, but really like mental and emotional fortitude. And the biggest reason I say all of these things is because if you are an educated, highly skilled person in our country today, like if you are in this conversation and typing in the chat window today, chances are you already are part of a very privileged minority. There's a high chance, right? Because you've already, you probably belong to the top 10%. What that means is that most of the people who are coming in with the skills to make an impact in the sector have actually high chances that they've also not lived a lot of the current realities that you then are going to experience, right? Like oftentimes, you know, many people here maybe have not actually studied in a government school, have not grown up in rural India. And so just be prepared for that. So that's just one that I would kind of double click on, like really being ready to have high empathy, humility, ability to unlearn. But yeah, you know, like you said, Rahul, I think just lots of, all kinds of skills are needed in the sector. So what we're really, when I look to hire, I'm actually looking for that plus, which, you know, which again, it does make it sound like, oh my God, like then how do I actually go about navigating it? But I would say no differently from any other job, right? I think, you know, start looking at the kinds of organizations. And again, I think like any career, trying to reach and say, what are the other skills that I need to build? So always look for that combination. What do you already bring in that gives you a little bit of a fitment? And then what's the direction that you want to go in and be a little wary of the additional skill set that you're trying to build?
Yeah. Thanks a lot, Akanksha. I think, just trying to summarize the first part of our discussion, we spoke about personal journeys, we spoke about what drives us, what drove us to get here. So being very cause-driven or the problem-solving mind, right? For Akanksha, it was education. For Vasudha, it was more around equity. And Kruti, it was more around professional goals, but at the same time, a personal goal of what happened to her son. But at the same time, how do you blend all of that? Think about skills which will help you create that meaningful career in the space. We constantly see a lot of questions here which are talking about, how do I upskill myself? how do I use my prior experience better? Because Akanksha, you mentioned that how all the skills are necessary, but how do I position myself specifically? Wanted to spend some time about how important are mentors, how important is the network? Because Kruti, you did also mention that 5 or 6 months prior to you joining ARC, you spent a lot of time understanding the ecosystem. So if you could break down in a very maybe brief manner about what you did in those 5 months, that will be helpful. Similarly, Akanksha, your transition, what helped you? What were some of the doors that you knocked on? What were the kind of conversations that you ended up doing with certain people? How important is that? Because I see a lot of lack of understanding of the ecosystem for them to apply to the specific roles that I see in the chats right now. Kruti, you want to take it first?
Yeah, sure, I can. So I think the first is find, so I think I took a fairly, you know, logical, perhaps rational approach towards solving this as a, okay, I want to move to the sector now, what are the steps that I need to follow, right? First step was, at least I need to understand the landscape, right? I need to do a, you know, I need to get a sense of what are the organizations that are out there besides, you know, Pratham and Teach for India. Then I had to figure out, you know, what those organizations actually do, right? So I tried to find connections, individuals that knew folks at these organizations, and just had conversations, right? Just to find out a little bit more about whether I relate to that organization and whether that's an organization I'd be happy at. So spoke with Madhav and Rukmini at Pratham. I had known Madhav from before. Had a you know, former colleague put me in touch with Shaheen at Teach for India. Again, I was fortunate and privileged to have the network to be able to find these connections, but you don't necessarily have to speak to the head of the organization, right? I think reach out through your network, leverage your network, and talk to folks that are working at these organizations, find out more about what they do, and then get a sense of whether you would be happy there. Then the third is did a little bit of due diligence about their program itself. Right. So try to understand the TFI model, you know, the fellowship model, building future leaders, et cetera, et cetera. Again, you know, all these organizations have evolved and changed over, you know, a decade or two. Right. Pratham has evolved so much. So wanted to find out in the here and now, what does the organization do and what is their intervention specifically? And then kind of got into the brass tacks, right, of what is it going to what is it going to take to actually crack the process, right? Because again, it's not easy to get into some of these organizations, right? I mean, everybody has their own process. They have been around for a while. They're looking for great talent, but you're also coming in with a different set of skills. So that matching is quite important, and you should treat it as any other rigorous hiring process that you might undertake in the corporate sector. So try to make sense of my strengths and how they would be valuable and how I could articulate them during the hiring process. I think that's the kind of approach that I followed, Rahul.
Sure. Thanks a lot, Kruti. Over to you, Akanksha. Like, what do you feel were very important steps that you took before you moved into the impacts, and any tips that you would?
Yeah.
So what I'm hearing is networks, ability to talk to the right people. And I think a lot has changed. Even social media has changed. I believe, Kruti, you may not have had all the resources that are available right now. You have a Glassdoor, which will tell you compensation. You have a LinkedIn, which literally has every employee of every organization. And I think you can also draw parallels to who are my clones at the current organization. Why can't I speak to them? So if I am a corporate crossover wanting to move to TFI, I can literally look up who are the 10 people working at TFI who are corporate crossovers. I don't necessarily need to have Akanksha's email ID to do that. So what Kruti also mentioned is you don't have to speak to the head of the organization, but try and access and leverage whatever resources you have in your network. But Akanksha, what do you think? What are some of the tips that you have for the audience?
Yeah, I mean, I'll share two big ones that I've learned as almost like life lessons. So one, I mean, exactly what Kruti said, like be prepared for that. I think any sector, any job, I would say you need to do your homework and you need to do your research, right? So literally how she outlined it, start learning about the sector. What are the mega trends? What are the sub verticals? What are the organizations? What's the work that they're doing? Therefore, what are the roles and therefore what are the skills they require? Right. And parallelly, you should really know, like, what are the things you're good at? What are the things you enjoy? What are the things you want to grow in so that you're able to, you know, create, start mapping and creating where the match and overlaps will lie for you. I think the life lessons I've learned, one is just don't be shy. You have to. And ultimately, no website or JD or, you know, can really tell you what the work is like or what the culture is like. Ultimately, organizations are made of people. So you have to talk to people, right? And I was someone who was actually, I mean, I think of myself as an introvert and a very shy person. But, you know, over time, I've learned that, like, people are just really important. And so truly, I think you have to kind of reach out, right? And you can start with LinkedIn. What I often say on LinkedIn is, 10 years from now, where do you want to be? Find a person that has that profile, right? And just reach out to them. Find 10 people like that and, you know, maybe 5 will get back to you. And what you'll also realize is probably 10 of them follow 10 different paths to get to where you want to be. Yeah. So, but talk to people because those journeys are really important. So you just have to reach out. And like Kruti said, sometimes you'll reach out to, you know, maybe you'll find a connection, leverage the commonalities, right? Maybe they went to the same undergraduate or the graduate school, or maybe there's a shared connection. But in general, what I've learned about people is people like to help other people. And so, you know, when you reach out and say, hey, I saw you also went to, you know, the same DU college as me. I'm also thinking of transitioning. It's just a high likelihood that, you know, people will come back. But ultimately, that's really important. You know, that's where you really get the real, you know, truths of all of these things that Kruti outlined. The second life lesson I've learned is the sector is different. So while we're saying you'll need all the skills and more, the advantage of the sector is that, you know, we don't really see ourselves as competitors. It's not like a Pepsi and a Coke who are fighting for talent against each other. Truly, I can tell you, like Kruti and I, like, we are more interested in getting people into the sector. And so I will very willingly tell her, hey, I spoke to someone who would be a great candidate for you. And that is something that's very unique and very special about the sector, right? So often I've found, you know, someone starts by talking to, you know, another organization, but they ultimately make their way to me because, you know, it is about getting, right now we're just in the phase to come into the sector. So we're more coming in, and that's very unique and something to leverage, right? Like I now almost tell people, don't tell me about TFI and what you're looking to do here. Just tell me what you want to do in the world. And if there's something at Teach for India, I'll find that. But I am more than happy to connect you with Rahul from Arthan or, you know, whoever, because we just want you in the sector if you're bringing the right set of skills and the right motivation. So long story short, I guess, my advice in a nutshell would be do everything that Kruti mentioned and then just start talking
to people. Yeah. And talking to people, not just with a job or a career in mind. You should also do correct. It even if you have made it in the development sector. I can bet Akansha, Kruti and Vasudha spend maybe hours in a week talking to people. And I think that value has to be followed. It cannot be transactional. Okay, I want a job right now in education. I'll speak to Kruti. But after I get a job, then I stop talking because social sector is evolving. You need to know, and knowledge is more important than the job itself. Yeah, sorry, Kruti, you were saying something.
There are two tactical things that I would say, right? One is I also reached out to search firms. So I reached out to Spencer Stewart. Arthan wasn't around at that time.
Yeah, yeah.
But you know, I think it's really important for folks to also reach out. I'm making a plug for Arthan here, but genuinely, you guys are looking at people who are transitioning, right? Another organization called Crossover Catalyst. Like, talk to search firms because they have a pulse of what type of skills are needed. The other thing I would say, just to build on Akanksha's point, on LinkedIn, right? what I found is a lot of people reach out to me on LinkedIn and send like long descriptions of their resume, et cetera, before getting to the point. I would just say, start with what you want to do. Right? Give me like the one-line summary at the beginning saying, I want to shift from here to there. This is what I'm doing. This is why I'm interested in people. And then go into your experience, right? Because everybody is overwhelmed by emails, LinkedIn requests, things like that. So that's just something tactical that I would say, just to make sure that you get a response from somebody at the organization.
Perfect. Thanks a lot. Thanks a lot, Kruti and Akansha. Vasudha, what about you? How would you talk about networking, mentoring? I'm sure you also started your own entrepreneurship journey, right? So how much of a role did an advisory board or people around you help you get there?
Right. So I think Kriti and Akanksha have outlined a lot of it. But I do think networks in the development space are very important. For me, the biggest thing that a network does is that it gives you a foot in the door. Beyond that, it's up to you. But the network is extremely important to get that foot in. So even when we started the organization, the first couple of years for us was very slow. We did work as individual consultants, small work that we brought into the organization, but we spent a lot of that time speaking to people, understanding what kind of work that they're looking for, what kind of research they're looking for. And that actually helped us shape and position ourselves. And it's that network and it's those conversations over the first couple of years, which has helped us really build to where we are today. And we continue to do that, of course. We don't get as much time as we would like. But irrespective, those conversations are extremely important because they also tell you what are the kinds of emerging issues. You know, there are so many people working on so many things, and it's important to know that. It's important to have a pulse of what is new in say EdTech, for instance, and that could give you an idea that, say, if somebody is using a particular technology for education, is there a way that I can adapt that, say to build a job portal or to use a similar technology in terms of healthcare. So it's important. Networks actually give you a lot of information on how the sector is moving, what's new. Specifically in terms of, I think, searching for jobs, I feel it's also important. We get a lot of applications that are generic, and honestly, we don't look at them. And the reason is because for me, then in generic applications, it's unclear for what you're looking for. And you're applying because you think that this may be something that you may want to do. But unfortunately, I think most organizations don't have the time to sort of go through all of that. So just like Kriti said, I think it's important to research up the organization, use networks to understand what a particular organization does, and to have your motivation clear on why you want to do that. And I think if that's clear, no organization expects, I don't ever expect that if somebody's going to come in with 100% skill set and exactly what I'm looking for, I obviously know that that's not going to happen. So I think it's important to use those networks to understand where you're heading and whether the organization you're looking for is actually fitting with the motivation that you have in your head. The second thing that I would say is allow time. Once you get into an organization, it takes a few months, perhaps at least 4 to 5 months, to understand the organization, how they work. So I think it's also important to allow yourself that space to explore within an organization what works. A lot of us are looking for quick wins. In my view, I don't think they exist. You need to give the organization and yourself some time to understand really what it is and where from there, within the organization or otherwise, do you want to upskill yourself, or is this something that works for you, doesn't work for you? So yeah, I'm going to stop there.
Yeah. No, thanks a lot. This is so relevant, Vasudha, that how you also need to solve for the challenges that organizations face, right, before hiring, because you can't let the whole aspect of hiring being thrown on the head of the organization. I know of a person who interviewed for 4 rounds with an EdTech firm, and the firm was very unclear where to hire this person because he was a very strong generalist but had never worked on the core problems that the organization was hiring for. But this guy called me up and said, what do you think this edtech firm is suffering from in terms of challenge for next 12 months? I told them they are trying to expand to 3 more states, but they have no clue how to go about it. So this guy spent the next 1 week to create an expansion strategy to enter those 3 states and shared that deck with the founder. He got hired 3 weeks back. So what I'm saying is, it's also important, how do you leverage knowledge and use the right network to figure that out? Because honestly speaking, every organization wants problem solvers. You can be a generalist, super generalist, specialist. I saw these terms in the chats right now. It doesn't matter which college you came from. Till the time you have that openness to solving a problem which is relevant today. But we can quickly take some questions because we are, 7-8 minutes away from ending the session. I will try to summarize a couple of questions. We have a couple of folks saying that middle and senior level shifts in the sector is easy, but entry level positions is difficult. I don't know, Sukriti. I don't think it's true. I think challenges remain on all sides. Every staff member at Earthen has never done human resource consulting, including me. I think we are all people who are learning on the job, and 90% of our staff are non-specialists. So I feel there are many more organizations like us that exist. I think at the entry level space, you should also focus on fellowships, etc., wherein there's a humongous amount of opportunity to solve for problems directly working on the ground. Any hiring manager biases that you had to break? Kruti, Akansha, any one of you wants to take a stab at that? Any hiring biases that you came in entering into the social sector and you had to break that away?
I think the tone that you set in the beginning is very important, right? Saying that you are, I liked what Akansha said about having the humility and showing that you're there to learn from others as well. I think that's really important. I also think that, if you're moving from the corporate sector to the social impact space, be fearless in your first 6 months, right? Because the first 6 months is when you still remember all the skills that you have. You haven't quite picked up all the skills in your new organization. So, don't be shy. Be fearless about asking questions, trying to get a sense as much as possible of, the sector, right? Establishing a network for yourself, finding mentors at other organizations that you can speak with and reach out to. I think those are some suggestions I have. I think that's the approach I took.
And I believe a couple of people have also asked, do you need to first work in the corporate sector, then shift to development sector? Not necessarily. You should ask Vasudha that question. She has never worked in the corporate space. She has constantly worked in the development sector. Also, I believe one big skill that you need to develop moving from the corporate to social sector is patience, because unlike corporate sector where you are focusing on a goal, you achieve that goal, then you move on to a new goal. But if you ask Akansha today, what is the goal that Teach for India has? We don't know if it will even get achieved in our lifetime, but you need to constantly strive for it. And you can't think of solving for it in 1 year, 2 years. There are so many people who come to me and say that I have learned everything in 2 years in my job. I need something else. And what do you want to say for that, Akansha? How much patience was it necessary for you to build at TFI?
That's a really interesting point. I'll tell you where I am in my own journey, Rahul. I think both are important. So one, I've become much more patient than I was, right? And partly, I was a trader. So literally trades happen microseconds. And so that's kind of what I came into. So yes, you do have to be much more patient, because when human lives are involved and the kind of change we're all trying to make, it just takes time, right? And I think even what we're up against is are very interconnected, deep-seated problems that have existed for centuries. So yes, at the same time, I do think, what the sector is also pushing for is a little bit of a higher pace. So to say that actually change can happen sooner. So, and I think that's been a really important thing for the sector, right? I think saying that actually maybe instead of doing this in 5 years, can we do it in one? Accelerating the pace and scale of, impact has been a big one. while at the same time holding patience. So I think that's something to definitely keep in mind. The sense, the time axis is different in the sector, so you should absolutely be prepared for that. I'll add maybe just one or two more, you know, like kind of closing thoughts from my side. Like just do your homework, right? And I think someone mentioned entry level versus mid-level and senior level. Like actually sometimes what I found is like, again, navigating your way through, right? So Kruti said, you know, like do all of these things. I said, talk to people. Sometimes I do see people jump to talking to people without having done their homework. That will take you many steps back, right? Like if you set up time to speak to someone and then say, what's happening in the sector, like they're not gonna want to help you. So I just want to caveat everything that Vasudha and I shared. Like the bold and underlying message, underlying though, is like do your homework. And at, you know, after graduation, some of those things like you've just not done, right? You've been studying. And so just make sure that that homework piece is done really strongly, so that, you know, every conversation is not just you getting something from the person, it's also you kind of coming and, you know, being prepared and sharing. So I think just doing your homework is one thing I would, you know, bold and underline. And then the second is what you mentioned a little bit on skills, Rahul. I think like one bias I would say is like, try to look at all skills as equal. I do find like sometimes there's a more heavy leaning towards, oh, project management is a proper skill, or strategy is a proper skill, or, you know, like people tend to gravitate and say, that's what I want to build. And so sometimes there's also, you know, like when people kind of traverse sectors, oh, but I already have these skills, so I have what it takes. I would say like team management is also a proper skill, you know, give it that time and same intention, you know, humility, user centricity. Like some of these things that sound like soft skills are equally important. So, you know, if you're coming in from the corporate background and you know, you like give that other side of your brain the same level of sincerity and seriousness to grow those skills. And so, you know, when people said, do you need to kind of go from corporate, I would say no. If you kind of hold that all skills are equal and important, you know, you could go always. I find some people who've really kind of only done the sector bring an incredible amount of skill. The question I start asking them later in their career is, but now how will you build some of the project management skills? Or like do you need to think about a graduate degree? Or, you know, like, so to me, the sector is going to demand very holistic skills going forward, because the nature of problems is multidisciplinary. Like, I think it's going to require right brain, left brain, hard skills, soft skills. So that would be like my big pitch. We need all skills. You can start anywhere, but just have the seriousness to build out that holistic portfolio of skills, because that's really what we need going forward.
Sure. And I would love to take one last question, maybe 2 minutes over time. Something that Shivani has asked, social pressure when she made the switch because of the pay gap, and as well as status. Vasudha, you did mention some bits about social pressure and you being a rebel. And Kruti, I'm sure you also took a massive pay cut when you moved to the sector. Maybe if you can both share a brief response to that. How did you tackle that? How would you like give some tips to the audience today? Like, how do you handle that? Vasudha, you want to share first?
Sure, I can. So, honestly, for me, since I've always been in this space, it wasn't, I mean, of course, it was a pay difference when I started the organization. But for me personally, there was always that motivation. And I just feel if your motivation is strong, it other things fall in place. Of course, there's always a pressure. But if you keep resolving that in your head, I think after a point in time, none of that really sort of matters. The second thing in terms of pay gap is, see, unlike, and this is something you mentioned also, Rahul, and Akanksha briefly touched upon also, unlike in a corporate space, if I increase my sales X, overall profit goes up by X. And so it's like a direct return. But here it's a social return on the effort that you're really putting in, and it doesn't always convert into a monetary value. So I do think while pay scales have improved massively over the years, I don't know if we'll ever be able to draw that sort of parallel because it's always going to be, there's always going to be a component of social return in the development space. And I think anybody switching should be cognizant of that. So yeah, I'll leave
Thanks.
It to Kruti.
Kruti, what about you?
So, I think with what the reason for the pay gap, right? And I think each of us, if we could pay corporate sector salaries, I think we would, because all of us want to attract the best talent, right? Just to provide that other perspective, right? Why the sector doesn't. Often it's pressure from funders and donors, right? Because when you actually, for it, especially kind of CSR, right? That look at, line item wise, what are the expenses? And their mindset has not completely shifted towards equity with corporate sector salaries. Therefore, you have to shift that mindset to the extent possible. But there are always questions raised about, well, why are you paying this person X amount, right? And isn't that too generous? And I'm saying that even for positions where we don't think we're particularly, over the top spending on that position. So I think that's just the perspective of why there is a delta oftentimes when you make the shift. I think the perhaps my advice to folks, right, is think about what is the delta that you would be comfortable with financially. Right. So when I made the shift, I think for me, it was I have a certain monthly cash flow. My salary that I would like to have should allow me to just meet those expenses. Right. And I think that's the sense I went in with in terms of, this is a lifestyle that I would like to maintain. And then this is the cash flow that would help me get there. And that's essentially where I landed. But then I had a clear number in my head that I was working with. And if you're transparent to the organization that you're interviewing with, I think they will try to accommodate that, because you're providing a particular reason and you're providing, you're laying out the homework that you've done to arrive at that answer. So your negotiation process on compensation becomes a lot more well thought through, as opposed to just randomly throwing numbers around.
Yeah, thanks a lot. And I also feel take into account people who can support you. I did a whiteboard exercise with my parents talking about pros and cons of moving to the sector. Because sometimes a rebellious me would want, I don't care about what they think. I want to move into the sector because I believe in it. But I am a conglomerate of people around me. If my parents are happy, I'll be happy too. So it's also important that you take into account what they feel, what they think about your shift. So bring them into the confidence. I still remember my parents coming and visiting my classroom in the first month of my fellowship at Teach for India, because I wanted them to see what this sacrifice meant to me. So what Vasudha shared, there is a social angle to what you do. And that cannot be put in monetary terms. So even for parents, loved ones, and even for society in general, you need to talk about that social gap, social, I don't know, what do you call it? Like, there's something which can't be put in an INR format, right? So it's important that you take into account all the feelings and motivations and put them on the table, because that's absolutely necessary. And you may realize that this shift may not happen in the next 1 year, 2 years. But that's important if you can define it. The last thing you would want is make the shift and then 2 months later you start realizing it was a mistake. Because that will be detrimental, not just for you, but also for the people you are serving through the role. But I think that's where I leave it. But it was great speaking to you, Kruti, Akansha and Vasudha. I know it was a virtual coffee chat, but would love to be in a real coffee chat soon. Hopefully, the world will become a better place to do a real coffee chat soon. All the best to everyone in the audience who are planning to make the shift to the social sector. Please feel free to write to us, ping us on various platforms. Happy to help you personally. I would say log off from here and move to the Career Connect session, which has started almost 9 minutes back. There are 9 organizations today who are actively hiring. Please feel free to connect to them and network not transactionally, but with a relationship focus, and looking forward to having all of you come and join the social sector and make India and the world a better place. Thanks a lot, all of you.
Thank you. Thanks so much.
Happy Independence Day.
Yes. Happy Independence.
Yes.